We begin tonight with what a self-proclaimed wartime president looks like, with more than 137,000 American lives lost in the war. And we should point out what you're about to see is how he wants to look. It's no accident. We're not about to show you some kind of unguarded, unflattering behind-the-scenes moment. No, this is a picture the president of the United States posed for and put out on his Instagram page. It's the image he chooses to project to the families and the friends and the children and neighbors of 137,000 of his fellow Americans. This is our wartime president today. And while there's plenty more that could be said about the idiotic way it came to be, the pettiness behind it, or the political calculations, if any, that went into it, the truth is any attempt to explain or contextualize this grotesque photo only adds the insult. So we'll let it speak for itself. We'll let it be exactly what it is, a picture of the most powerful man on Earth facing the most serious challenge on Earth right now in the Oval Office behind the famed Resolute desk and a can of beans, plus a few other items from aisle 9. Thumbs up, orange, grinning like he's just won a prize. 137,000 Americans dead, and this is our self-proclaimed wartime president's answer to it. He hasn't been to a coronavirus task force meeting since April, we're told. He's been doing everything he can to undermine our nation's scientists. He ignored for crucial weeks the spread of this virus. He's lied about it, thinks it just will magically disappear. And given the death toll and the spread of the virus, you might think he might be spending every waking moment trying to combat it, talking to victims' families, rallying Americans to be patriotic by wearing a mask, washing their hands, protecting their neighbors. But no, this is what he wants the world to see. The infected, the recovering, the newly grieving. Anyone on Instagram, the more clicks for this president, the better. So we want to just hold up this picture. We want to give the president what he is so obviously craving. We're going to keep this ridiculous picture up while we tell you about what is happening on his watch, starting with this assessment today from the nation's top infectious disease specialist and senior member of his own task force, the one he's been undermining, that is when he's not posing with canned beans.
The problem is, since we started off our baseline so high, as we tried to open up, and what we saw was it went from 20,000 cases a day to 30, 40, 50, and now we're hanging around 60,000. That's untenable. We've got to turn that around.
In fact, as we left you last night, new data came in from the Johns Hopkins University School of Public Health showing another 67,417 new cases. That's the most ever in a single day anywhere on Earth. The majority of whom will develop symptoms. Many will be hospitalized in just a matter of weeks. By current mortality estimates, of those 67,000 people, about 2,700 will die. Nationwide, new cases are now rising in 38 out of 50 states. They're holding steady in 9 and dropping in just 3, Maine, Delaware, and Arizona. For Arizona, though, which has been hit so hard lately, this may not be a sign the worst is over. A record number of people are hospitalized, and as Dr. Quinn Snyder from Mesa, Arizona, told us last night, there's no room left for more. Patients, he said, are being transported elsewhere or even out of state because ICUs are simply out of capacity. Also, as you might imagine, deaths are trending upward and positivity rates remain above 20%. That is when people can get tested, which many still can't. For the first time in the outbreak, Houston's death toll is in double digits for a single day, and hospitals there are full. Miami-Dade County today reported it is now out of ICU beds. Dr. Aileen Marty, who's been on the program several times recently, said today, quote, on a scale of 1 to 10, we're at a maximum capacity, we're a maximum urgency. We need to turn this thing around right now. Florida's governor has still not even issued a statewide mask mandate. Alabama's Republican governor today did. Oklahoma's governor, who attended the president's rally in Tulsa, he has now tested positive. Walmart, the nation's largest retailer, is now requiring all customers to wear face coverings in their store. The president, though, having shown that he can wear a mask, once again refused to during his trip to Atlanta today. He did not wear a mask, did not mention the lives lost, did not mention the record case count or how to get those numbers down. But he did once again say that he thinks there are 21 different names for what he calls the China virus, because apparently that line sounds funny to him, despite the fact that comments like that stoke racist sentiment against Asian Americans. He also blamed others for the campaign he's been heading lately, not against the virus, but the man fighting it, Dr. Fauci. He threw his trade advisor, Peter Navarro, under the bus after Navarro, who has zero knowledge of viruses or epidemics, but likes to talk about how he went to Harvard and understands science because he's a social scientist, wrote an op-ed criticizing the nation's foremost expert in the field.
We're all on the same team, including Dr. Fauci. I have a very good relationship with Dr. Fauci.
Well, that's Peter Navarro, but I have a very good relationship with Dr. Fauci.
The president doesn't even have the courage to publicly attack Dr. Fauci. That's how weak he is. He has his hangers-on do it, like Peter Navarro, and he winks at them and nods approval. But publicly, when the cameras are rolling, everything's great with Fauci. But he's undercutting him every step of the way. They don't allow Fauci on our town halls, on a lot of television programs anymore. They don't want you to see him. They send him to other meetings when the few times the virus task force is holding an actual briefing, or at least the last time they did. That's our wartime president, the guy sitting behind his desk with cans of beans. And that's what the president is doing, in addition to endorsing cans of beans, with 137,000 Americans dead and many more dying. He's trying to do damage control on the damage that he himself has done. In a new Quinnipiac poll, only 30% of people surveyed said they trust the information the president is providing on the outbreak. Frankly, it's startling that it's that high. 67% said they distrust it. For Dr. Fauci, that figure is reversed. He's trusted by a margin of 65 to 26%. Which may explain why he's been marginalized, kept off national television. It may explain why the president has retweeted Fire Fauci memes about him and undercut him in public. According to reporting, the Los Angeles Times, the president himself approved of that Peter Navarro op-ed, the paper citing one administration official who said, quote, not only was he authorized by Trump, he was encouraged. That's the way this president works. Publicly denies it, privately he encourages. But the president apparently did not have the guts to admit it publicly, and we shouldn't be surprised by that. Or to tell the public why he disagreed with Dr. Fauci. The man who claims to know more about the military than the nation's top generals apparently has nothing to say now, but Fauci thankfully does.
They are really, I think, taken aback by what a big mistake that was. And I think if you talk to reasonable people in the White House, they realize that was a major mistake on their part because it doesn't do anything but reflect poorly on them. And I don't think that that was their intention. I don't know. I cannot figure out in my wildest dreams why they would want to do that. But, I mean, I think they realize now that that was not a prudent thing to do because it's only reflecting negatively on them. I can't explain Peter Navarro. He's in a world by himself, so I don't even want to go there.
The fact is, though, Dr. Fauci's wrong. He's not in a world by himself. He works in the White House. He works for the most powerful man in the country, and there's a reason for that. There's a reason he is in the White House, because the president wants him there. So Dr. Fauci is trying to ascribe good motives to a lot of folks in the White House who maybe are talking to him and privately are saying, gosh, that was a really terrible thing. We don't know why he would do that. We feel terrible about it. But they won't say that to the president's face. They'll say that to Fauci privately. They won't say that publicly. They don't have the guts either. And that's why they work for the commander-in-chief, because he has no guts either. Whatever the answer, the administration today put out this picture of Dr. Fauci at today's task force meeting. They're following the lead of the president. Publicly, again, they pretend everything is fine. So here they put out very intentionally a picture of him talking with Vice President Pence. But again, behind his back, they try to destroy the man who has more credibility than any of them. None of this would matter, wouldn't amount to a hill of beans, but this is our president, and people are dying, and people are sick, and more will die, and more will get sick, and our economy is in shambles. We're in a public health battle for our lives and our futures. And the president is sitting there behind the resolute desk, resolutely clutching at beans. Joining us now, CNN Chief Medical Correspondent Dr. Sanjay Gupta, also William Hazeltine, former Harvard researcher and recent author of A Family Guide to COVID, Questions and Answers for Parents, Grandparents, and Children. Sanjay, so another day goes by, Americans dying, still no plan from President Trump and the federal government. We've had this conversation over and over again, and with the good Professor Hazeltine as well. But without federal engagement, Professor Hazeltine in the past has said that, you know, the answer is, you know, each of us doing all we can, and citizens and everybody else, stakeholders, being involved. But without federal government, does this get better?
I think it's very hard for it to get better. Clearly, the status quo is not working, Anderson. The numbers continue to get worse. I think what we're seeing now is we're seeing a pattern. The reason that the federal sort of guidance is so important is because what happens in so many communities now and states is that things get into a real crisis situation before action is taken. I mean, people know what to do. I mean, the public health sort of strategy is actually not that complicated here. We've seen it work in certain states in this country for periods of time. We've seen it work in countries around the world. I mean, we don't have to remind people that there are countries around the world who have had, you know, they've had fewer people throughout this entire pandemic who have gotten infected than has happened in certain states in just one day in this country. So the public health strategy is obvious. But, you know, what's happening is these states basically are redlining, and then the virus makes the decision for them. They got to either go into some sort of shutdown mode because the hospitals are becoming overly full, or they're going to, you know, have these terrible situations where people can't get care when they need it.